left on the topic of disease. Mikey had a facial scar and Bobby was a racist. They were all in love with dying, they were doing it in Texas. Tommy played piano like a kid out in the rain, and then he lost his leg in Dallas, he was dancing with the train. They were all in love with dying, they were drinking from a fountain that was pouring like an avalanche coming down the mountain.
I don't mind the sun sometimes, the images it shows. I can taste you on my...
Okay, so welcome back, everybody. This is basically part two of the victim and eyewitness memory lecture. This part will focus more on eyewitnesses or eyewitness testimony, eyewitness memory. The last lecture focused a little bit more on the victim side of memory and testimony. Excuse me. So when we talk about the effects of accuracy of eyewitness identifications, Gary Wells is a pretty prominent researcher in this area. You can see 1978, the year I was born, is when he created this taxonomy to categorize the variables that actually affect an eyewitness's accuracy. And the first part of this taxonomy deals with system variables. So what is a system variable? Well, it's variable that's under the control of the criminal justice system. So this would include the procedures by which eyewitness identifications are made, or the procedures in which lineups are conducted. And we're going to spend quite a bit of time talking about that. I'll show you videos of different actual eyewitness or lineups being conducted, and good ways to do it and not so good ways to do it. Estimator variables are also important in determining the effects of different variables on eyewitness accuracy. And an estimator variable is a variable that is beyond the control of the justice system. And its effects can only really be estimated. So it's not something that we can change systematically, right? This is something that usually it's something that is involved in the crime scene itself. So an example here is the lighting at the time of the crime. So effects on accuracy, better lighting should result in more accurate identifications. Poor lighting should affect the accuracy of identifications in a negative type. We also have what's known as post-diction variables. And a post-diction variable does not directly affect the reliability of an identification, but it correlates with its reliability. So an example of that might be the confidence of the eyewitness. So when an eyewitness says that they're 100% sure, they're fully confident that the person they picked out of the lineup is the person that they saw commit a crime or the person that assaulted them, that would be a post-diction variable, except it's not a really good one. There's a lot of controversy over eyewitness and victim confidence, especially when it comes to picking out people from lineups. Some research shows that confidence is related to more accuracy, and some research shows that confidence is related to less accuracy, and some research shows that confidence has no effect on accuracy at all. The problem with this is that confidence is really convincing. So not just convincing to, say, a jury. I mean, you can imagine, and we see it in movies and on TV, but it does happen in real life. It's, you know, can you identify, is the person who assaulted you in this courtroom right now? Yes. Can you point them out? That person right there, they did it. And how are you of that? I'm 100% sure. I would never forget the face of the person who did that to me. Damn. As a defense attorney, you might be like, oh, that's not good. As a juror, you might be saying, shit, this person seems pretty sure of themselves. The problem is the research doesn't back up that type of justification to feel that this person is actually accurate just because they're confident. Again, just letting you know my biases. I'm a pretty skeptical person. So anyone who's 100% sure about anything, I personally tend to question that. Because if you know your limitations, and you know the limitations of just human memory, and you're familiar with internal, you're familiar with confirmation bias, and you're familiar with implicit, prejudice, you really shouldn't be 100% sure about anything, right? So even atheists who are 100% sure God doesn't exist, I'm like, take it down a notch. What about 99.9%? Like, kind of leave some room, right? In there. So, for me, sometimes the more confident someone is, the more suspicious I get about whether or not they're accurate. Another variable, post-diction variable, is response. And this is something that the research is actually a little bit more clearer on, or that we have a little bit more reliable results, meaning that repeatable results, something we see over and over again. And when we talk about response latency, this is how long it takes a person to identify a suspect from a lineup. So if it takes a victim or an eyewitness less than 10 seconds to identify someone from a lineup, the research shows that they're about 90% accuracy. There's about a 90% accuracy rate for 10 seconds or less. Once we get over 10 seconds in order to identify somebody out of a lineup, that accuracy rate drops to about 50%. So now we're talking about a coin toss at that point, right? So that is one post-diction variable. Again, it's not directly related to how accurate they are, but it's correlated. It could kind of give us an idea of accuracy, or how accurate the victim or the eyewitness is when making their identification. Okay. So eyewitnesses this is another controversial area of research, but something that is just true and we see happen all the time, and it's actually resulted in many false identifications and innocent people going to prison. But eyewitnesses are usually better at recognizing members of their own race or ethnic group than they are people who are of other races or other ethnic groups. And this is actually known as the other race effect. So it's also colloquially known as they all look the same type of effect. We actually do have difficulty identifying people of other races, and that's not exclusive to white people. It's any race or any ethnicity have more difficulty identifying people who are not of their own race or ethnicity. So you can imagine the type of problems that this causes in terms of false identifications. If you're a victim of somebody who is of a different race or ethnicity of you, you run a greater risk of misidentifying them in a lineup, or if you're an eyewitness to a crime, you have a greater risk of misidentifying somebody if that person who you saw or you think you saw committing the crime is of a different race or ethnicity than your own. There are also age and gender differences in terms of the eyewitnesses who's making the identification. So evidence for gender effects tends to be pretty weak, but the trend is that the trend seems to be that there's an own gender bias. What does that mean? Well, we tend to be more accurate in identifying people of our own gender. And again, the research for this isn't really that convincing. But again, the trend, there is a trend there, at least for women. The research when it comes to men is a little less convincing, but the research overall isn't that convincing. When it comes to age, older eyewitnesses and make more errors than, say, younger and middle-aged adults. So, for example, they're more likely to choose someone from a lineup when the culprit or the suspect is not actually in the lineup. So they're picking people in the lineup as the suspect when the actual suspect isn't even there. So there seems to be some effects for age. The effects again for gender are mixed, but there seems to be a trend in the data. So how can we make this better? How can we make these lineups better so we have less errors in here? Well, police have actually finally begun to incorporate some of the procedures that are recommended by psychologists. Decades worth of research here, and police departments and law enforcement agencies are actually implementing some of these reforms and some of these procedures, because the science is pretty overwhelming. The research is pretty overwhelming. It'd be almost negligent to not adopt these procedures when interviewing eyewitnesses or victims and when constructing lineups. In a landmark decision, the New Jersey Supreme Court, just pretty recently, I mean, 2011 doesn't sound that recent, but, you know, all things considered, this is a pretty recent decision, only 11 years old here, about a decade old. New Jersey Supreme Court, no offense to you, Jersey folks out there. The New Jersey Supreme Court lists more than a dozen factors that judges should consider in evaluating the reliability of an eyewitness identification. One example would be the weapon focus effect, right? So if there's a presence of a weapon, remember, judges are the ones who decide whether or not evidence can be admitted into trial or not. So it's really important that judges understand the research that exists behind some of the problems that are inherent to the procedures that we use, to the way some of the problems that exist with eyewitness identifications, that exist even with, say, expert testimony, which we'll get to in a couple of weeks in a different lecture from now. This is a pretty important decision made by the New Jersey Supreme Court, is that they're recognizing that eyewitness identification is not all that it's cracked up to be. Judges, here's the list of things you should look for before admitting this stuff into testimony, into evidence. Why? Well, you have to remember, like, what we've seen in previous videos, and what I'm sure I said a dozen times in the last lecture, eyewitness testimony is really powerful testimony. Aside from DNA evidence, eyewitness testimony and confessions are the most damning. So if even without a shred of DNA evidence, if you have a confession and you have an eyewitness, shit, you're going away for a long time, statistically speaking, of course. Unless you have a bunch of money to hire some good expert witnesses to come in and tell the jury how confessions are a bunch of bullshit and how eyewitness testimony can be a bunch of bullshit. And shameless plug, I work for cheap, especially for former students, so you could always hit me up. I don't know. You get what you pay for, so don't expect a lot from me. Don't expect to get off, right? So how does, when we talk about reforming these procedures, what is the standard police interview? Well, you know, what is it that we need to reform, that we're trying to reform? Well, in a standard police interview, there's a set of predetermined questions that a victim or an eyewitness will be asked, and there's really little opportunity for any type of follow-up. There are lists of questions. A lot of them are yes and no type of questions or very close-ended questions. We can do better with that by using a cognitive interview. So in a cognitive interview, the interviewer, the detective or the officer, will establish rapport with the witness. So much like we saw with how interrogations work, the first step would be to establish rapport with the witness, then ask him or her to provide a narrative of the events, right? So let them tell their story. Tell me what happened in their own words. You don't stop and ask, you know, specifics or anything like that. You let them tell their story in their own words, in a narrative, without any interruption. When they're done is when you can start probing for more details. That's when you can start using specific questions. But only after they have established their narrative. There's a number of reasons for this. Number one, asking very specific questions that are predetermined, that are kind of one size fits all, you're probably going to get pretty standardized one size fits all responses, number one. Also, because these questions have very little opportunity for follow up, you're going to potentially be missing out on a whole bunch of important aspects of their answer or aspects of the crime. I mean, you might not even be tapping in or asking them, to offer certain information that's going to be very useful in solving the crime or prosecuting the suspect. So having them talk and just give their narrative first, they'll often give a lot more information, or even information that you didn't even think of asking. Then there's always the time at the end to follow up for more specificity, right? To ask more specific types of questions. And if they didn't address something that you wanted them to address, you still get the opportunity to do so, right? Okay. Also, when we take a look at this, the comparison between, say, a standard interview of an eyewitness compared to this cognitive interview, the research suggests that the cognitive interview is shown to generate substantial increases in correct recall. The problem is it could also produce a small increase in incorrect details because it's open-ended, so people can mess up. You know, the more we talk, the more errors that we're going to make. But generally speaking, the consensus is that this type of cognitive interview approach actually produces the benefits of the greater correct recall outweighs any small effect of increased incorrect details in there. So let's see what else we got here. Okay, when it comes to the lineup procedures, another area that we can change, right? This is a system variable. This is something that the system can do differently. So when it comes to lineup procedures, there are typically two ways to do this. But we said before there were two ways. The in-person lineup, right, where the people are standing against the wall and you got to pick somebody out, or you're presented with some photos here. But both the photos and the in-person, stand in the room and pick the person out, those are both what we call simultaneous presentations, or simultaneous lineups. So this is the traditional lineup. And in this type of lineup, all the lineup members are shown to the witness at once. So it's simultaneous. And we see as an alternative when we study the stuff in the lab, an alternative to the simultaneous lineup when you present all of your people and the suspect along with a bunch of foils in there. An alternative is to do a sequential procedure. And this is when you show the victim or the eyewitness one suspect or one person in the lineup at a time. So instead of showing them all at once, you're going to show them one and then another and then another. So you're going to show them in sequence instead of simultaneously. Now, we're going to see how the procedure works and why one of these is better than the other. And hopefully you can guess by now, if we're talking about the traditional lineup being simultaneous and we're saying there's an alternative, I'm hoping you can guess that the research shows that the alternative, the sequential procedure, is actually better to use. It results in less errors and more accuracy. But let's maybe not quite yet. I think after this slide, we have a video that shows how this stuff works. So let's just talk a little bit about why this works here. Well, in a sequential lineup, we see that it results in fewer identification attempts in general. So both mistaken and accurate identifications are reduced. What does this mean? Well, because you're showing people one photo at a time, people actually have to think about the person that's in front of them, right? So there, if you show everybody at once, what is happening is that an eyewitness or a victim, who is technically an eyewitness, so we'll just say eyewitness, an eyewitness is comparing, let's say, those six or nine people on a piece of paper or those nine photos. They're comparing them. They're supposed to be comparing all of those pictures, all of those faces to the image of the person they have in their head. But typically what happens is that they make what's known as relative judgments. So remember in the last lecture, that little exercise of that guy who was doing something or other, and then they showed us the lineup, and I said, every time I watch that video, I said, it's always either number three or number six, right? I was like, I'm pretty sure it's one of those guys. What am I doing? Well, I'm making a relative judgment. I'm comparing how much does this person fit the description compared to how much this person fits the description. That's really not good. So, you know, we tend to identify the person who looks most like the culprit relative to other people, right? So which one of these people looks more like the culprit? Okay, that one looks most like the culprit or the suspect or the assailant, but I mean, it's just in comparison to the other ones, really, right? So this is what we don't want to do. We don't want to make relative judgments. We want people to compare each individual subject in that lineup to the image of the perpetrator or the assailant that they have in their heads. And the best way to do that is through a sequential lineup, right? So by using a sequential lineup, you're showing one image at a time. So they don't have the opportunity to compare, right? If we go to this image over here, where I laid them all these pictures out, you're not comparing this dude to that dude and say, well, he looks more like the perpetrator than that one, so he must be it, right? Instead, you're going to be showing those pictures one by one. So the eyewitness is going to compare each one of those images to the image of the perpetrator or the memory of the perpetrator that they have in their head. We call this an absolute judgment. So they're not comparing the people either in the physical lineup to each other, which one looks most like the culprit, or in the picture array lineup. Instead, you're going to be asked one by one which one best matches the image or the memory that you have. So these absolute judgments tend to produce much more accurate results. I think I have some videos in showing actual police trainings of how to conduct these lineups. Let's see what this one is. There's two of these that look exactly the same. Okay, so just by the title here, I can tell you that this is an example of a proper police sequential photo lineup. So this is how we should do it. When I say it, I'm talking about a lineup. This is the correct way, according to the research. This is the best way to conduct a photo lineup. And that would be to do it sequentially. So we'll watch how it's done here.
Katie, this is Officer Fundora.
How you doing?
And he's going to administer a set of photos to you after I read some instructions to you.
Okay.
And let me remind you that everything that's taking place right here is being audio and videotaped.
Okay.
So it's on the record, and I'm going to read a set of instructions, and Officer Fundora is going to show you a photo array. Okay? You are being asked to view a set of photographs. You will be viewing the photographs one at a time and in random order. Please take a look at all of them. Officer Fundora is required to show you the entire series. Please make a decision about each photograph before moving on to the next one. The person you saw may or may not be in the set of photographs that you're about to view. You should remember that it's just as important to clear innocent persons from suspicion as to identify the guilty. The officer showing the photographs does not know whether any of the people in the array are the person that you saw. The individuals in the photographs may not appear exactly as they did on the date of the incident because features such as head and facial hair are subject to change. Regardless of whether or not you select a photograph, the police department will continue to investigate this incident. If you select someone, the procedure requires the office ask you to state in your own words how certain you are. If you do select a photograph, please do not ask the officer questions about the person that you've selected, as no information can be shared with you at this stage of the investigation. And regardless of whether you select a photograph, please do not discuss this procedure with any other witness in the case or the media. Do you understand everything before we begin?
Yes.
Okay. If you understand that, I'm going to ask you to please sign that top line with today's date of July 30th. Now I'm going to leave the room, and Officer Fandora is going to show you the photographs, and he'll let me know when you guys are done at the end.
Okay. Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Are you ready to begin?
I'm ready.
All right. I'm going to pass each of you one at a time.
No, that's not him. No. 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 Yes, this is him.
Okay.
This is
him. Without using a numeric scale, tell me how certain you are.
I'm positively certain. I would never forget him.
Okay. Okay. Could you put his initial at the bottom? Okay. Just remember, I have to continue showing you the rest of these photos, okay?
Okay. No. No.
Thank you for your help. I'm going to walk you outside.
Thank you.
Okay, we're done here.
How'd you make up?
All right, she picked one up positively, sir.
You wouldn't know. That's the guy.
This is the one she picked up.
That's the guy. How sure was she that this was the guy?
She said positively certain she wouldn't forget that face.
Okay. That's exactly the guy we're looking for to pick. So, I'll let Detective Gova know.
Just before we move on to the next video, the next slide, hopefully some of your 221 and 222 training is kicking in here. And you see how that lineup was actually kind of conducted almost like an experiment in terms of it following a set of procedures and not deviating from those procedures, right? There seemed to be, you know, what we would call experimental control taking place in there. Number one, we saw that first guy who came in the white shirt, we're gonna have to assume that that's wasn't in uniform, so he's gotta be high up there in the ranking. He came in and said, these are the procedures that are gonna happen. The officer who is conducting this lineup, he doesn't know who the suspect is. That's really important, right? That's really important that the person who's administering the lineup doesn't know who the suspect is. Why? Well, because we could give off some clues. It's called the experimenter effect. We can give off some clues as to, you know, who the person we're looking for is. If we're going through showing each of these photos and that woman is saying no, 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 and then she says no to the person who is, excuse me, our suspect, and we, even if we just hesitate a little bit before taking the photo back, she might say, okay, wait, could I see that photo again, right? Because those are what we call demand characteristics. Those are little types of clues that exist within an experiment or exist within a study that kind of gives away our research hypothesis to our participants. And in this case, in a lineup, those demand characteristics would kind of be like a hint, hint, wink, wink to the eyewitness in terms of who our suspect is. Another thing that was good about that lineup is to let her, that woman know that the suspect may or may not be in the lineup. So that will help reduce some of that implicit pressure, some of that internal pressure for her to feel the need that she has to pick somebody. Be like, no, the person might be in there. They might not be in there, right? So don't worry. Like, don't make any rash decisions type of kind of communicating that to the eyewitness. Also, when it comes to the way that the eyewitness is presented with these photos, they don't stop as soon as the eyewitness identifies somebody. They have to see every person in the lineup. Why? Well, again, we're assuming that the eyewitness is making absolute judgments here. So they're taking a look at the photo and they're comparing it to the image that's in their head. So it's possible that that person looks very similar to the image that's in their head, but the next person or the person after that looks even more like the person that's in their head. So we want them to compare each of the photos, and we don't want to stop once they hit somebody, right? Once they say, yep, that's the person. Something else that was good in there was to ask the person to express how confident they are without using a numeric scale. So no 100% or anything like that. Tell us how confident you are using your words, using a narrative, because that will often give us some more information. Right? She said, I'm positive that's it. I would never forget that face. Okay, that's a pretty convincing statement of confidence rather than I'm 100% sure, right? Well, why 100%? Is it because it looks most like the suspect compared to all those other guys in the lineup? So there's some really good aspects of this sequential photo array. We're going to see an example of a sequential lineup done in person. Again, these are becoming increasingly rare, but they still exist. But instead of doing a simultaneous lineup where we have all the suspects lining up at once, we're going to show the eyewitness each individual person in the lineup separately so that they can make an absolute judgment. I'm pretty sure that's what the next video is. If I could get to the next video, we're gonna come back to this in a minute, okay? Let's take a look at the other one.
Hello, I'm Chief Bill Brooks of the NOAA Massachusetts Police Department. We know that DNA has exonerated over 300 people of crimes they did not commit. We also know that in 3/4 of those cases, the innocent suspect had been mistakenly identified by an eyewitness. With the help of scientists, we have identified some of the reasons witnesses make errors. Many have to do with conditions beyond the control of the police, such as lighting, the suspect being of a different race, or the amount of time the suspect was in the witness's view. We have also learned that there are techniques the police can utilize to minimize the likelihood that an eyewitness will identify the wrong man. Included among them is instructing the eyewitness in a specific way, making sure to tell the witness that the person they saw may or may not be one of the people they will see in the array or lineup. Others include displaying photos or people one at a time, using officers who do not know who the suspect is, and asking a witness how certain she is of an identification as soon as it occurs. These so-called system variables are reforming the way police officers conduct show-ups, photo arrays, and lineups. Today, we are going to talk about live lineups. In fact, because lineup participants are presented to the witness individually, they don't really line up anymore. So how do we conduct a lineup or a live array in today's blind sequential world? That's what we're going to talk about today. The first step in conducting a lineup, of course, is the selection of fillers who will stand with the suspect. The general rule of thumb is to select fillers who resemble the description of the offender as given by the eyewitness, not fillers who look just like the suspect.
Hi, Cindy. Thanks Hello. For coming in. Nice Thank to see you. We'll go right this way. Officer Hawkins, this is Cindy Cady.
Hi, nice to meet you.
Officer Hawkins is going to help us out with this. If you could stay here with him while I get a few things squared away, I'll be right back.
Okay, thank you.
Why don't you have a seat?
Thank you. I'm just a little nervous. I've just been through, it's very nerve-wracking.
Okay, Davey, come up to the door, turn around. Right at the waist, hand behind your back. Now we're going to go see us for the lineup. You can't be number one. Whatever number you want to be.
I'll be three.
Okay, let's go. You ready? Alright, it's going to look like this, gentlemen. You're going to come in. Stand in front of the line.
Before the lineup actually begins, it makes sense for the detective to demonstrate for the fillers and suspect what they should do when the lineup is in progress. This ensures that they all do the same thing in the same way and follow the instructions appropriately. The officer standing in the background will be one of the blind administrators. He does not know who the suspect is in the investigation.
To your right. Okay. Okay, Cindy, Officer Hawkins is going to be in the room here while we do this. Do you have any questions?
No.
Okay, I just want to read you the instruction form.
Okay.
Okay, you are being asked to view a group of people. You will be viewing them one at a time. Please look at all of them. I am required to show you the entire series. They are in random order. Please make a decision about each person before moving on to the next one. The person who committed the crime may or may not be one of the people you are about to view. You should remember that it is just as important to clear innocent persons from suspicion as to identify the guilty. The officer administrating this procedure does not know whether any of the people were involved in the crime. The individuals you view may not appear exactly as they did on the date of the incident because features such as head and facial hair are subject to change. Regardless of whether or not you select a person, the police department will continue to investigate the incident. The procedure requires the officer to ask you to state, in your own words, how certain you are of any identification. If you do select someone, please do not ask the officer questions about the person you have selected, as no information can be shared with you at this stage of the investigation. Regardless of whether you select a person, please do not discuss the procedure with any other witnesses in this case. Do you have any questions before we begin?
At this point, Detective Gover is going to sign the form and ask the witness and the uniformed officer to sign the form. He has explained to the witness that Officer Hawkins does not know which of the participants is the suspect in the investigation. He is our second blind administrator. Once the form is signed, the detective leaves the room. This is the last time he will see the eyewitness until the procedure is concluded.
I'll be right outside, okay?
Okay, thank you.
Number one, can you come into the room? Stop that black mark. All right, turn and face the door. Turn around and face me. Turn and face the glass. Number two, can you come into the room?
Here, the participants are receiving instructions from the uniformed officer standing in a corner of the participant room. He's positioned himself in such a way so that he really cannot be seen from the other side, although, because he does not know who the suspect is, it would not matter if he was visible. He's giving each boy the same instructions, that they should enter the room, face the glass, turn one way and then the other, and then face the glass again. In this case, the NOAD Police Headquarters is equipped with a room that facilitates lineups. The participant side has the light on, so that people on that side, when they look at the glass, see their reflection. The observation side has the light off. That's where the witness is located, and the witness can see through clearly. This is a view that the witness has of the lineup, but the participants cannot see her through the glass.
Number four, can you come into the room? Turn and face the door. Turn around and face me. Turn and face the glass.
In the so-called old days, lineups were conducted by having the participant actually line up, so the eyewitness could see them all at once. But in the blind sequential world, similar to with photo arrays, the participants are presented to the witness one at a time. So instead of the participants lining up, they actually line up in the corridor and are brought into the room one at a time. As you can see, the witness cannot make comparisons, cannot perform so-called relative judgment, because she only sees the participants individually or one at a time.
Number six, can you come in the room?
This lineup only involves six participants, and it's the standard size for a lineup. But of course, the eyewitness does not know that.
Turn around and face me. Turn and face the glass. All right, number six, you're all set.
Can I see number three again?
We can show you the entire group.
Okay.
I would like that, please. Just going to go through the array or the lineup one more time. But we see the same type of safeguards that are present there, but we actually skipped one slide. So if the suspect or not the suspect, if the victim or the eyewitness asks to see one person in the lineup, they actually have to repeat the whole process again. And that's where I stopped it, just because you saw how the process works first time. You don't need to see it happen again. But when we talk about the influence of feedback, I'll go through this slide that I skipped and then talk a little bit more about that video there that we just saw. Lineup is typically done by a detective who selected the fillers or the foils and knows which person is in the suspect, or which person is the suspect, rather. So which person in the lineup is their suspect, their culprit. So in a traditional type of lineup, the detective has the potential to introduce a whole bunch of bias into the lineup procedures there. So we can see by knowing who the fillers are and who is the actual culprit, this can increase the likelihood that an eyewitness will choose somebody, even if it's not the culprit, but just choose anyone in general. Also, the lineup should be done by someone who does not know which person is the suspect, or if the suspect is present at all. And as we saw in both sets of videos and both instructions, the officer who was conducting the lineup did not know who the suspect was, or if the suspect was even in the lineup, and neither did the eyewitness. That's good lineup procedures here. Eyewitness's confidence is one of the most compelling reasons why jurors believe such identifications are accurate. So an eyewitness saying, I'm 100% certain that that's the person, and they're pointing at them in court, that's some pretty damning evidence there. So we want to make sure that we get this lineup right. We want to make sure that the procedures are used, that we use are correct, and you know, based in what the research shows, will produce the best identification, the most accurate identification. So eyewitness confidence is being picked out of a lineup is pretty damning, and having an eyewitness say they're 100% sure it's you is really pretty damning. So again, we want to make sure we get this right, particularly because we saw already or discussed already that eyewitness confidence is not a great predictor of accuracy, right? Just because someone's confident does not mean that they made the right decision here. So in the courtroom, we know that jurors put a great deal of weight on testimony from an eyewitness, but even in our last lecture, for victim memory, we saw that Loftus and her research on memory, well, in one particular study here in 1974, gave subjects a description of an armed robbery resulting in two deaths. And in 18% of the people who were presented with this case, or 18% of the subjects, 18% of those, rather, presented with only circumstantial evidence against the defendant, convicted him. So let me just rephrase that. I've been video recording lectures all day. I'm not sure I'm making sense here. So in this study in 1974, Elizabeth Loftus conducted a study on eyewitness testimony in terms of how important it is in securing a conviction about an armed robbery in which the person killed two people ended up dying. So there were two groups. One group was presented with only circumstantial evidence, which means there was no eyewitness testimony, just physical evidence. And in that group, 18% convicted the defendant. As soon as she added an eyewitness account, just one eyewitness, to that other group, so they got the circumstantial evidence along with an eyewitness identification, the conviction rate rose to 72%. I hope you can see how that illustrates how important eyewitness identification or eyewitness testimony really is. And now we know how unreliable it is. Hopefully this is concerning to you, right? Some of the safeguards. Well, we saw some of these safeguards already. The way that police conduct lineups, using these types of scientific methods that we saw in those videos, make identifications more accurate and make the likelihood of picking out an innocent person less likely. So we could definitely start there. But what if you're stuck with a really crappy eyewitness identification? Some pretty bad procedures there. Some potential safeguards that we can use in the courtroom involve informing jurors about whether investigators followed these guidelines for lineups, which have now been adopted by the Department of Justice. So we can inform and educate jurors about what makes good and bad eyewitness identifications. And this might be done by allowing expert witnesses to testify. So allowing people who study this, who are experts in the field of eyewitness identification and lineup procedures, to allow them to testify to educate the jury about good and bad procedures and what kind of procedures were used in that particular case. Judges could also instruct juries about the potential weaknesses of eyewitness identifications and suggest how to interpret this testimony. We'll talk a little bit more about this and the suggestion about allowing expert witnesses to testify once we get to the topic of expert testimony in the courtroom here. The issue with this, in terms of judges instructing juries about the potential weaknesses of eyewitness identifications, is that a lot of judges don't know the weaknesses of eyewitness identification. So I'm not sure how successful this could be. But judges could limit eyewitness testimony. So portions or all of the eyewitness testimony would not be admissible in court. Again, judges have a lot of discretion. This is something that we talked about very early in the semester. They get to determine what is admissible and what is not admissible. And, you know, some judges are better than others in terms of identifying bad procedures or unethical procedures, or not even just identifying, but actually caring about keeping that stuff out of the courtroom. So these are potential safeguards. Again, if we lived in an ideal world, we wouldn't need these suggestions. So whether these suggestions would be implemented or not is up for debate, right? When it comes to children as witnesses, this is, remember, children are a protected population when it comes to research. So even trying to conduct research on child witnesses is difficult, particularly when it comes to trying to examine children as witnesses, particularly if they're victims of crimes, not just witnesses, but victims as well. There are some ethical issues that get in the way and kind of make this research difficult. But when we take a look at, say, lab simulations or say mock trial type of studies, we see that children are generally less accurate than adults when it comes to making eyewitness identifications from a lineup when there's no suspect in there. So children are more likely to make false positive errors. In other words, they're likely to pick somebody even if the culprit or suspect is not in the lineup. So what are some possible solutions here? Well, giving children the option to say that they don't know, that they're not sure. I mean, this is one of the solutions that we use for adults that seems to work. Just by letting adults know, adult eyewitnesses know that it's okay to say that you don't know, or the person, I don't recognize any of these people. Letting them know that is an option, that could actually reduce this type of internal pressure to pick somebody. Also, informing children witnesses of the importance of making a correct decision decreases guessing on the part of the children, which in turn will lead to false identification. So if you stress to children witnesses, and again, the same principle applies to adults as well. Adults also have, you know, feel this sense of social desirability. They want to be helpful. If you stress to adults and children, but particularly children, if you let them know it's okay, you know, to say that you're not sure and that, you know, being right is more important than picking someone. It's just very important that you are correct. This also will reduce guessing and false positives in there. When it comes to interviewing children, eyewitnesses, as with adults, the first step is to build rapport. You want to have a open conversation, make the child feel that they can talk to you, that you are somebody that they can trust. You then want to encourage children to provide details in their own words. So again, we're taking a cognitive interview approach to interviewing children, because children are very malleable in terms of leading questions, right? You can, based on how you ask a question and what kind of question that you're asking, you can get kind of any response out of anybody, but particularly a child who wants very much to be cooperative, and who might not have the skills to know better, or the confidence to say no to an adult, particularly an adult in a position of authority like a police officer, right? So after the child provides their narrative, we could follow up by asking specific questions about the event. The issue is that children tend to be less accurate with those specific questions. So specific questions ask for memories the child may have encoded or may have never encoded, rather, or may have forgotten. Remember, a child's brain is still developing there. I can tell you, at my age, I'm remembering what the hell I said yesterday. So you can imagine a younger person, a child, would have difficulty in terms of what they're able to encode and what they're able to remember, what they're able to retrieve. So we have to be cognizant of the limitation of children's memories. Also, children may answer a question that they don't fully understand just in order to be cooperative. Again, if they're talking to an adult, and if they're talking to an adult who's in a position of authority, particularly a police officer, right, who's in uniform with the badge and all that stuff, that could be very intimidating for anybody, but particularly for a child. So they might answer questions that they don't really understand. And specific questions can easily become suggestive questions, and if I remember to do so, I'll link a documentary for you to watch, and maybe even write one of your discussion boards or something on it, involving, you know, the satanic panic that happened in the 1980s, and you know, children coming up with some pretty wild stories about satanic ritualistic abuse that was basically, I mean, there's absolutely no evidence to suggest any of that stuff happened, but the children were saying these things, you know, happened in various daycare set, and consensus is that, yeah, the children came up with these stories due to suggestive questioning by therapists and by investigators of these crimes. And after that, you know, protocols have been put in place about how to actually question children. You can't question them the same way you would question and adults, but yeah, adults are vulnerable to suggestive questioning as well. So when it comes to children in the courtroom, so children in the courtroom is a difficult subject, especially when it's a child victim in the courtroom, because the Constitution guarantees us the right to face our accusers. At the same time, we have to worry about the psychological, emotional trauma that a child might experience by facing their abuser in a courtroom. So this is often left up to there's no simple answer or simple solution to this. It's usually left to the discretion of the judge, or the jurisdiction might have some type of guidelines as to how this might happen. But though most children or most child maltreatment cases end in admission of guilt or plea bargains, tens of thousands of children, often preschoolers, have to testify in abuse trials each year. That's really quite traumatizing, right? Pretty sad. Prosecutors will often go out of their way to, and sometimes, you know, rightfully so, people will get really angry at prosecutors for giving a lenient sentence to somebody who abused a child. But it was likely part of a plea agreement so that the child wouldn't have to testify in court and cause more psychological harm. And that's often done with the consultation of the child, the child's parents, and also at least one clinician who has evaluated the child, most likely multiple evaluations. But what is the effect on the child of having to discuss these issues in court? Well, it could go either way. Talking about victimization in a public setting could definitely increase trauma in children. But for some children, it could actually be therapeutic. Is that particularly if, you know, if they were told to keep things secret, having, you know, like telling it to the world, so to speak, can actually be helpful for the child. But most prosecutors and most therapists and most parents probably don't want to risk it. And that's why we see a lot of plea bargains when it comes to cases where where a child is the victim. You don't want to put the child on the stand. But what happens when you do have the child on the stand? How do jurors perceive child witnesses? Well, they're generally viewed as less credible than adult witnesses, except for cases of child sexual abuse. But in any other case, you know, having a child up there as an eyewitness to a robbery or a car accident or something, jurors tend to perceive them as less credible. When they're up there as a victim and thus witness to child sexual abuse, younger victims are viewed as more credible than adolescent or adult victims. And there's evidence to suggest that jurors can recognize the effects of suggestive questioning, which is a good thing, even though suggestive questioning, police departments and social workers have been trained to not do suggestive questioning and to recognize when they're doing it and to avoid it. It still happens, but it seems that jurors are able to to recognize when a child has kind of been suggestively told or questioned in such a way to come up with a story that may not necessarily be true. In order to try to mitigate some of the trauma that children might experience by testifying against their abusers, various jurisdictions, judges have allowed a whole bunch of different types of courtroom modifications to try to protect children from the potential stress that comes from testifying. One of the techniques is to put a screen the child and the defendant, so the child is still taking the stand in the courtroom, but they're not able to see their accuser or their abuser, or to use video conferencing, meaning that the child is actually in a separate room just outside of the courtroom, and the questioning and cross-examination can be done through video conferencing. So there have been a couple of different studies that examine how jurors perceive these types of measures, and the results are not conclusive. We still need some more research to see whether or not having a screen between a child witness and a defendant, or having the child testify from a different room, is actually more damaging or damning to the defendant, just in terms of, you know, implying that they're hurting the child or have hurt the child, right? Like, how do jurors perceive these types of safeguards? Remember, when it comes to defendants, no matter what they're charged with, no matter how heinous their crimes that they're charged with, they're still innocent until they're proven guilty. So, you know, those are constitutional rights that need to be respected, need to be upheld. And when it comes to dealing with children and potential trauma, that's something we also need to take into consideration. So certainly more research in this area would be very helpful, at least in my opinion. And that seems to be it for this lecture. So looks like this is the first one I've actually ended in 1 hour and 13 minutes, so a normal in-person class lecture. Okay, I'll shut up so I don't go over that time. I'll see you all next time. Take care. Bye-bye.